It's my pleasure to welcome you to this second monetary policy and financial stability statement of this year. So as MC said, we do this twice a year, and we normally touch the economic conditions that are related to the mainly to the business of the bank. So as you notice, we won't go into any details on the fiscal sector, though we slightly touch on the real sector, because what we do impacts or is influenced by the real sector. So our main mandate as a central bank really on the monetary sector and the external sector. And so we try to bring to you what happened or what the situation has been in the last 6 months. That's the overview. I don't want to go, I don't have to go through it. And as usual, we start with the what's happening globally, because we're not an island. We operate as part of the global economy, and what happens in the global economy affects what happens in our country. So starting with the GDP overall performance, or expected performance of the GDP this year, as we can see today, the expected performance of the global GDP is 3.1%. And this is much lower than what had been projected last year. Last year in October, the IMF had projected that the global GDP would grow by 3.6%. This was revised in April to 3.2%. And recently in July, it has been revised even further down to 3.1%. And this is mainly due to challenging global conditions, as you see in different parts of the world. Specifically for the advanced economies, expect a growth of 1.8%, which is lower than 2.2% achieved last year. And this is mainly due to still persistent low productivity in these economies and weak global demand. Then the financial volatility still exists in different parts of the world. And the political turbulences we see in especially the emerging markets also affect the performance of the advanced economies. Brexit still remains a concern. We don't know as yet the impact of this to the global economy in general, but it still remains a lingering concern that will affect the overall performance of the global economy. On the emerging markets, the growth was also revised to 4.1%, that's 2016. Originally it was at 4.5%. And this is linked to mainly commodity prices and the continued weaker performance in China, weak performance compared to the double-digit growth we were used to see in that big economy. Then, as I said earlier, political tensions in Brazil, Russia, in the Middle East, turbulences in Turkey, all these affect the overall performance of the emerging markets. I think what's more surprising here is the expected performance of the, we've been used to good performance in sub-Saharan Africa, normally we've been averaging around 5% growth. And for the first time, we are really almost towards 1%, at 1.6%. Originally targeted, projected at 4.3%. And this is mainly linked to issues of commodity prices and drought across different countries. And some of these are big economies. Nigeria itself is having negative growth. I think the first quarter they have negative 13% growth. And as you know, this has been the first economy in Africa. And because of that, it has been, again, overtaken by South Africa, though it's also not really doing that well. So the big economies have been affected by the commodity prices. And we see drought affecting economies like Ethiopia, Kenya, Malawi, and even the region in general. You see even our country is also a bit hit by the drought conditions that you see across the region. The table here really gives the details of what I've been saying, so I don't have to go back to it. Just breaks down the growth in different countries, as I've been talking of regions. So you have it in the booklets in front of you. So you can see the details there. The other point to note here is the inflation. Of course, inflation is our main mandate as a central bank. This is something we monitor at global level as well. As you see, it's expected to remain subdued globally at around 0.7% compared to last year's 0.3%. This is mainly to somewhat slight change in fuel or oil prices. Last year we had a sharp decline of 47.3%. So this year, though it's still declining, but with the less margin of 15.2%. So that somehow eases the sort of deflationary pressures we saw in the developed world and slightly increases the global inflation to 0.7%. And as we see, we expect the central banks to continue employing accommodative monetary policy. I think it has gone beyond accommodative to something that is not used to this world in terms of the monetary policies we see in different parts of the developed economies. Back to our region, ESC, we still see moderate inflationary pressures, not really anything big to worry, though in our case in Rwanda, it's for the first time that we are above the rest of the countries in the region at 6.9% last month. This is the highest we've had, I think, since 2011. And this is mainly due to food prices that I had said. But we'll go into details of that in the slides to come. So this gives details of the commodity prices that I had said. This impacts one both on the growth numbers but also on the inflation numbers. So I don't have to go into details as well. This is really what I've been explaining. Now looking at the national economy, so that was the context. The global economy gives us the context in which we operate as a country and therefore impacts on the performance of our economy in general. As we saw from the Institute of Statistics numbers published earlier, we had good performance in the first quarter at 7.3% overall economic growth in the first quarter compared to the 6% projection we have for this year. When we look at the second quarter, we still see good performance, though slightly lower than what we had had last year. So when we compare first half of this year, normally in the central bank, before we get to the final numbers from the Institute of Statistics, we have frequent economic data we use to project what the performance of the economy would be in any given period. So when you look at the first half of this year, we see what we call the composite index of economic activities growing by 13.7% in real terms, compared to 14.4% achieved last year. So there's a slight decline in overall economic activities compared to last year. And anyway, I think that speaks to the overall projection of 6% for the year compared to 6.9% we achieved last year. And when look at the turnovers, there's also a slight decline. The growth is 11.1%. compared to 13.6% achieved in the first half of last year. And the main drivers, as Arya said, is the sluggish global economy. So it's still impacting heavily on our commodity prices, and that is affecting or slowing down the economic performance as we see. And this is slowing down, it's not negative growth. We still have good growth numbers, though it's slightly lower than what we achieved last year. And as you can see on the turnovers, the biggest negative growth is on mining, growing by negative 36.7%, directly linked to the prices, the international prices. This takes me to the external sector, our performance in terms of exports. Because of the challenges with with the commodity prices, we see our exports growing negatively in the first half of this year by 2.4%. Compared, that is in value terms, but when you look at the volume, it grew by 16.5%. So in actual fact, the what we export is increasing in terms of volume, but because of the reduced commodity prices, we see a reduction in the value. And the table below shows the developments over the last 3 years, 2014, 2015, and today. We are comparing the first half of each year. As you see, we had a reduction last year. From 293 million we had achieved in 2014 to 275 million in 2015. That's the first half of the year. And today we are at 268 million in the first half of the year. And as you see in the details in the booklet you have, this is mainly linked to the bad performance in the mining sector, reducing by 36%, as I had earlier said. We see also bad performance in tea, though we had a good performance in terms of volume, but because of the prices, we see reduction in the value of our tea exports. Yet this is compared to slightly good performance in imports, good performance because we saw imports growing by 3.3%, but that in the overall performance of the economy creates a challenge of a widening current account deficit, trade deficit, and our import, the export cover reducing from 24.3% last year to 22.9% this year. So our exports are able to buy us less goods on the international market now, which is in fact the biggest challenge today we have as an economy, is this performance of our export earnings. Now going to the monetary policy and inflation developments. Throughout the year, as we have been communicating every quarter after the Monetary Policy Committee decisions, we've maintained a prudent monetary policy, which we can say really accommodative since 2014. And this has had impact on the increase of the financing of the banks to the private sector. What we see in the first half of this year, the new authorized loans increased by 18.3% this year compared to 10.8% we had achieved last year. And core inflation is picking up slightly to 3.4% from 2.1% we had in the same period last year. However, the headline inflation has picked up even faster. As we see here, we see average for the 6 months, but when you look at month or year on year, as we had earlier said, it has gone up to 6.9%. I'll come back to that. Yes, so this is inflation. What we see here, we've had pressures coming from food prices, and this is linked to the drought we had said earlier that is almost across the region. So that has really pushed up inflation for the big part of this year, because since November we had inflation at 4.8% and has averaged around 4.7 until June, when it picked up 5.5 and now at 6.9. So food prices are the main drivers, and we expect this to, if all goes well, if we have good climatic conditions, we expect that by November, December, we should be seeing a reverse in this high food inflation. But we see also now the factors of the international or the global market kicking in. We saw the yen appreciating against the dollar, and as we depreciate against the dollar, that impacted heavily on the prices of cars imported from Japan. And as you know, the majority of the cars used in this country are imported from Japan. So that has also kicked in the 6.9% you see. so that's where we are getting pressures, and we expect by the end of the year, with food inflation reducing, we expect to see the trend change. But between now and October, we expect this inflation to remain slightly high. On the monetary aggregates, so broad money growing by 6.1% compared to 16.7% we saw last year. This is again linked to the slightly slowing down performance in the economy in general, as we saw in the first slides. Outstanding credit to the private sector growing by 7.9% compared to 15% we saw last year. Though new authorized loans were growing by 18.3%. This is also linked that some of the, or most of the new authorized loans are short-term loans, so they don't really impact a lot on the outstanding credit to the private sector. And deposits are growing by 6.1% compared to 17% we saw last year. Currency in circulation continues to reduce because of continued access to financial services across the country and use of electronic means. So more money is kept in banks and less cash is being used to transact business. So that's why we see currency in circulation continuing to reduce year on year. So generally speaking, these numbers here show a slight decline in the performance of the monetary aggregates compared to last year, which really translates into the slightly, or linked to this slight slowdown in the performance of the economy in general. New authorized loans, this is just a breakdown of the sectors where the new lending went and the shares of these sectors, so I don't have to go through this. As always, we try to track a distribution of loans to by gender. And what you see here is we still see a big, which is almost constant for the last more than 5 years, the share of women in access to loans compared to men still remains around 23%. So we need, as policymakers, to really analyze more on this, what it means and what can be done to reverse this trend. On loan rejection, we normally give you loan rejection per sector, and the overall loan rejection this year reduced slightly to what we had last year. I think we introduced this slide because we normally had complaints that banks don't give out loans, and we track how many loans were requested and rejected, and as you see here, we see an increase in the loan rejected to 2.1% in number of loans, and reducing from 3.4. And the trend is really a reducing trend. So one would wonder whether that means that more people are getting loans or more people don't bother to go to ask for loans. But in any case, when we see less rejections, the conditions we normally give of why we see this loan rejection here means there's improvement in those approaching banks to ask for loans, improvement on this side of the conditions required for anyone to get loans from the banking sector. On interest rates, I think what we see here, what has really changed is the money market rates. TB rates has started gone up from an average of 6.8% in December 2015 to an average of 7.7%. Same with the repo rate going up from 2.4% to 4.1%. Interbank rates going up by 3.7 to 5.9%. And these were, we saw slight reduction in liquidity in the banking industry in general, and that pushed up these rates, or but also government was slightly active towards the end of last fiscal year, and that pushed up the government paper rates you see there. But on the deposit and the lending rates, that is always an interesting topic discussed in this forum here. It remains more or less the same over the last 3 years. In fact, when you go back, even 13, 12, it's always oscillating between 17.5 and 16.8. So there's that stability in the lending rate and more or less the deposit rate. So the conditions behind this still remains really mainly unchanged. So this is something that we'll come back to, I'm sure, during the discussions. We try to compare our interest rate to the region. The Rwanda, the green one represents the Rwandan level of interest rates. Uganda is a bit an outlier with a blue curve that is really in the 20s for almost all the time since 2010. As you can see, as I said, the Rwandan interest rates have been relatively stable, but when you look at 2010 going to today, there's been slight reduction, though very slow, but at least you see a slight reduction in overall average lending rates for our banking industry. The yellow one is the Kenya interest rates. You see some hikes 2011 because of the challenges they had. The monetary policy was tightened and therefore interest rates went up. As that was eased, it went down. Last year they had same challenges. They had to tighten their monetary policy again and interest rates went up accordingly. And that has remained a bit high above the other two. Tanzania is more or less same trend as Rwanda. So as we just wanted to show where we are vis-a-vis the conditions in the in the region, which are more or less similar across the region. On the capital market developments, we normally highlight this because as a central bank, we are a key partner in the development of the capital market, but we're also a key beneficiary. As the capital markets develop, we to enable ease the transmission mechanism of the monetary policy decision. So we very active working with the other stakeholders here. But here we're looking at mainly what we've been doing in terms of the T-bonds. We reintroduced government paper on the capital market since 2014. And the good thing to note is that since then we've been able to issue a government paper, a T-bond, every quarter. And we've risen our yield curve from 3 years to 5, 7, 10. And in February, as you all know, we issued a 15-year bond that was successfully subscribed to. And just this week, we've concluded a 5-year bond. So we've had good developments and good performance on the bond market that we expect will continue to support growth of the capital markets. Of course, as we always discuss with our colleagues in the Stock Exchange and the Capital Markets Authority, the government bonds are really to set sort of the yield and the benchmark, and we expect to see other business entities. Can only make sense if we have business actors using this as a channel of mobilizing resources. I think we've set the pace, we've set the yield curve. At least you have a benchmark that you can base on issuing a corporate paper. So I hope the corporates here and our colleagues in the Stock Exchange and CMA will be able to bring on corporate paper on the market. That's when we can talk of a developed capital market. For now, I think the activity is still really limited. But the good thing we also note is the composition of the investors in the government bond. We used to have predominantly banks investing in the government bond, and today we've seen the share of banks reducing from almost 90% to less than 50%, and the non-bank institutional investors taking up the lion's share at 52.2%. And the originally non-existent retail investors have now taken up a share of 3.4%. So that gives us confidence that we see more players coming on the market, and we see regional players as well investing in the T-bond. On the exchange rate, by 16th of August, we had the Rwandan franc, the official depreciation rate, at 6.9%. I think today we've reached about 7.5% depreciation. So this year we've had big pressures on the exchange rate, mainly linked to two main factors. The biggest one, of course, is the bad performance in our international trade, less export receipts, more import demands. So that automatically puts pressure on the exchange market. And we've seen big investments as well, which some of them are already reflected in a big import bill, but others are now paying back the debt. And so the demand of foreign exchange on this market has greatly gone up because of the strategic investments that were made. We always give an example of the big hotels that have just been completed, the Kivuat that has started paying back their loans. So all these are strategic investments that are big, that require big foreign exchange. In the short term, before they start generating foreign exchange themselves, it was bound to put pressure on our exchange market. So that has really resulted into the slightly higher, or the higher depreciation we are seeing this year than we've ever experienced in the last almost 10 years. So at around 7.something% today, when you had projected about 8% by the end of the year, that is high. But as we always tell people, I see discussions in different forums on social media as like the doom is really happening in our country. This doesn't mean really negative alone. So for us, from the economic side, we don't think this means just negative, because we are, as I said, we are not an island. We are not an island, we're in the global market. So competitiveness matters a lot, and competitiveness, the value of your shilling, or the competitiveness of your currency, matters a lot in terms of improving exports and improving domestic demand. So even if we had the capacity to maintain the franc without any depreciation, at the end of the day, we just make our economy very uncompetitive. As we've seen depreciation across our regions, last time we were here discussing why CIMERWA is finding challenges to sell cement on the market. If we are not careful and we make our currency really that strong, we end up hurting our own industries and are not able to trade or to compete even on the domestic market, leave alone our exports competing on the international market. So I just want to assure people that while we are having 7.5% depreciation, it doesn't mean we don't just see negative part of it, we see a positive part of it as well, as increasing our competitiveness as an industry. And people should avoid just taking that as simple mathematics. You see people trying to compare what the franc was 5 years ago and what it is today. Depreciation of 30-something%, therefore automatically my purchasing power has gone down by a third, which is not true. All this depreciation does not transform into inflation. Our main concern is inflation. So we see slight pass-through of this into inflation, but that should be the concern. I think we don't trade in dollars here in Rwanda. So when people start looking at their cost of living and their capacity to buy commodities on the local market, they should be looking at the capacity of the Rwandan franc they earn to buy them goods. When you start trying to compare that with dollars, I think we are losing the point. So it's not really simple mathematics that you can easily exchange dollars into Rwandan franc and straight away know how your purchasing power has reduced. So we always, our main concern, as we always told you, is how this is really passing through to inflation, how it's impacting inflation in general in a country. But of course, we wouldn't want to see double-digit depreciation. It's just the structure of our economy. but doesn't mean that we should come up with all weapons to fight any depreciation of our currency. I think this is really explaining the what happens. This table here we put up is to show, and mainly happy that we have our colleagues from the different government agencies and ministries that help us in growing the real sector. The table here shows four commodities that we think we can reduce their import bill if we really had focused efforts as a country. On cement, we are happy that today Simerwa will be able to supply this the demand of the economy and maybe be able even to export the surplus. So as you see in the first line on cement, we already see the import be reducing in the first 6 of this month, and we expect this to go down even further. So the 85 million we've been spending on importing cement, we expect in the next 1 or 2 years to have gone to almost zero, or in net, in terms of net, the export of cement to import of cement should really net out to positives. The other we see that still takes good amount of our dollars is sugar. We know the Minister of Commerce with other government agencies are working on introducing an investor into another sugar factory. So we hope this also depends on how quick this is going to be done, but we would expect this also to really be reduced to almost zero. Wheat still remains a challenge. I don't know if we have people from agriculture here, but we know we grow wheat in Rwanda. We are told our wheat is not what maybe the industries here need, but we can do something about this as well. This continues to take our dollars, and we think we shouldn't be spending dollars on importing wheat that we can grow in our country. And rice, of course, big investments have gone into rice production, but as you can see, the export bill of rice still continues to go up. I think this, again, as a country, we need to see what can we do to reduce or to completely eliminate the import bill on wheat. So as you can see, almost 240 million of imports of commodities that if we had concerted efforts can be produced in this country. This is one of the areas I'm sure we have Minister of Finance here, we have Minister of Commerce, maybe in the discussion session they will say something about it. The drive to made in Rwanda, use of made in Rwanda, should be focusing on these as well, on how we invest in such commodities that take good amount of our dollars. I think that's it on the economic and monetary policy side, but it's directly linked with the financial sector. As again, our second main mandate is stability of the financial sector. So we give highlights of the performance of the financial sector. This first slide just shows the composition of our financial sector, and as already said, still predominantly made up of the banking industry, and but that's no more. It's still a developing economy, so we see at least other sectors picking up, and we hope this will continue to. Their sectors will continue to grow. And now focusing on the performance of the banking industry, we see a good performance in the first half of the year. Growth in the growth in almost all the assets, the deposits, the loans. The deposits had already indicated growth of 10.3%. That is year on year. That's June last year to June this year. Outstanding credit growing by 19.3%, and the assets of the banks growing by 13.9%. So we see good performance in the banking industry, and even when you look at the, I think on the second side where you see the other indicators of the stability of the economy. So we see a strong base. Yes, we see, we measure the stability and the resilience of our financial sector by the capital adequacy ratio of the banks. So it's way above the prudential requirements of 15% at 23.3%. So that gives us confidence that we don't expect any shock that can destabilize our banking sector. Slight deterioration in the non-performing loans. So about two or three banks have had challenges here, and they have impacted on the overall ratios for the industry. But we are working with them, and we hope this to be reversed soon. Return on assets and return on equity slightly reducing, mainly due to high costs we see in the banking industry. Then the liquidity, we still have good liquidity, as we saw they continue to lend to the private sector. So this table shows really the indicators that we focus on when you're looking at the stability and the health of the banking industry, and we can assure you that we still have a healthy banking industry that can continue to support growth of our private sector. On the microfinance sector, good performance as well, growth of 22.8% of their assets, loans growing by 28%, and deposits growing by 20%. We see also growth in equity. Here we show details of these numbers, including the Orange Sacco as well. While we see down there good slightly good performance in the non-performing loans, reducing from 7.9 in December to 7.5 in June this year, as the microfinance industry in general, but there's concern with the SACOs. The SACOs have their non-performing loans have deteriorated. In fact, we don't know whether we call it a deterioration, but because we've had targeted inspection in these circles, at least we're able to see misreporting in different circles, and therefore, as we bring out the actual position in these circles, we see their non-performing loans going up. So the efforts we are putting together with the other stakeholders to consolidate these circles is very important that we expedite this, because we see big challenges of governance in the circles. The elected organs there are very weak, and therefore at the end of the day, the few staff that are in these circles totally mismanage the business of the circles, and therefore working together to consolidate these circles into entities that can employ qualified staff, can have board members that have capacity, is key to stabilize the Mrenje circles. But when you look at the other numbers, there's been great increase in terms of the depots, in terms of access to finance by the population. So it's a key factor that we need to focus on as policymakers to avoid losing the good cause we had as a country. Insurance sector, this shows the overall performance of the sector. We also see increase in the assets by 11.6%, increase in capital 9.2%, gross premiums increasing by 16%. These are indicators of the health of the insurance sector. As you see, claims ratio is should be maximum 70% within. I think what I need to say here, I'm sure most of you again know that we've been having challenges in the private sector, in the private industry of the insurance sector. So these numbers are sort of maybe masked by the good performance in the public part of the insurance sector. So there's a lot of efforts going on between us and the investors in these institutions to reverse the trend. As always, we have out of like 12, we have some good number of insurance companies that have been not doing really well. We've just issued new directives that will try to iron out the negative practices we've seen in the insurance sector. And we are working with the association to also streamline the negative competitions we've had in this sector that has really affected the private insurance sector. So you have the details in the booklet, and I say we are working with the different companies that are in Sore State to really improve on their numbers. On the pension, we still have one pension institution, the RSSB, and the numbers here show that it's doing well. We've just completed, we've just published regulations that allow registration of private pension funds. So starting September, we shall start registering private pension funds. So we expect that by the next monetary policy and financial stability statement, we'll be indicating what the other, the private sector pension funds are doing. And we expect that to really do more or improve on the performance, even performance of the pension sector in general. So, but as you see here, there's generally good performance with the RSSB in terms of assets and the revenues. On access to finance, I don't have to go back to the results of the FinScope, good performance in the last 4 years. And we see what we continue to see, at least in the outreach. We see the banks and the other financial institutions continuing to extend their outreach to the population, so which gives us confidence that the good performance we saw in the access to finance will be cemented, but also more, the 11% that is still outside the financial sector will be reached, and most likely, I mean, most importantly, the 32% that we have four more at 68%, and so those increasing those accessing formal financial services, because we see the branches of the banks and the sub branches increasing by 5% between the 2 years, the bank accounts increasing by 1.8%, mobile money accounts increasing by 22.5%, and most important here is the banking agents increasing by 45.8%. Banking agents have been really used to cash in and cash out and such other transactions. And I know some of the banks are already working on using these banking agents as sources to open bank accounts. And when that starts happening, we'll see a big change in the access to finance and more people being able to work with banks. So at least we've been seeing increase of these agents, and they're getting used to working with customers as sort of bank branches. Therefore, more products will be added to their menu, and that will increase or will impact positively in the overall access to finance. On the payment systems, we normally look at how we are modernizing our payment systems with the aim of going cashless anytime soon. So we see more value being transacted through our RIPs in the central bank. So volume of electronic payments growing by 65%. That is comparing the two halves last year and this year. ATM numbers growing by 10%. As I always say, the most important thing here is the points of sale, because that's when we can talk real of cashless. That's growing by 27%. And transactions here growing by 39% in value. But I think the growth of 84%, the fact that more people are using points of sale, I think that's very important. Though we're still far, but the developments are positive and give a good indication that the drive to reduce cash transactions is yielding results. The table here shows the performance in terms of numbers, mainly on the mobile financial services, which is another channel for really expediting use of electronic means. I don't have to go into details. As you see, it's good performance both on the mobile banking, on mobile payments by telecoms, and on the internet banking that has also seen big growth, and that's positive. So as I conclude, what do we see going forward? We expect to continue to see slowing global economy with negative impact on external sectors. So we continue to, we expect this year the performance of the exports, we don't expect to see that turning around into positive. So we'll have challenge, we're still having a pressure on the, therefore pressure on the exchange rate going forward. And this is also linked to the food prices, as I earlier said, in the short term, at least between now and say November, we expect to continue seeing pressure on the on inflation because of continued increase in food prices. Therefore, the exchange rate pass through into domestic prices is expected to continue during the course of this year. So we intend to continue or to maintain a prudent monetary policy with appropriate liquidity management to avoid any pressures from the liquidity side. And as the Monetary Policy Committee, we continue to monitor the developments and take appropriate action when need arises. And on the, I've already said this, we expect to see, to continue seeing pressures on the exchange rate. And depending on what we see in the imports, as I said, they have investments, this pressure might be a medium-term phenomena, maybe 1-2 years, as we expect to start seeing now results of the big investments we've done in increasing investments that yield more foreign exchange. On the financial stability, of course, we continue to enhance the regulatory framework. As I said, we've just issued a new legal new directive on the insurance sector. We should want to the microfinance sector, especially targeting the SACOs to try and reduce the malpractice or deal with the malpractices we saw there. So we continue really to focus on weak areas within the financial sector to maintain the stability and soundness we see in our financial sector. I think that summarizes what I've just said, and thank you for your kind attention.